We chose that city.
You tried it out?
Yeah.
Is there room for three on that?
It's very comfy, isn't it?
Well, that was what
there is, don't get too comfy because you won't be staying there for very long.
We did say that into consideration, didn't we, Patrick?
Yes.
So we have. Let's do this,
please.
Pyramid. I said I got as far as saying let's do an X.
Right.
And then I waited for Patrick and then continued.
I love Perigons. Yeah.
Before we start, I know. You know when I closed my eyes and I was listening and I wrote the odd little thing, my handwriting is actually different. Just wondered if that was any.
Maybe because you can't see it.
And I open my eyes to write.
Oh, do you?
I'm not that good, yeah.
It's smaller.
What?
Much smaller, it's half the size.
Maybe that's what? Maybe you've learned something valuable about.
Just need to find out what it is.
Yeah.
So I can identify it.
Sorry
about that, Peter.
So, one of the things we talked about earlier in the week was if you look out on a hillside, and you see houses dotted around, how do we know that the house is different to the hillside?
Because it's got a different construction.
Perspective.
Yeah.
It's different colour.
And people might say things like the hillside, the trees and so on, but people often say that they're natural and the house is man-made.
Mm.
And how do we make a distinction between something that's natural and something that's man-made? How do we know that a man didn't make that tree and stick all the leaves on?
Well, until we get close up to it, we don't know.
There are some pot plants out on the patio that look quite real, but actually when you look at them close up, they're man-made.
Yeah.
They're pretty good facsimile.
There's some camels that were natural, but actually they were man-made.
Man-made camels.
Candles.
Oh, candles.
Because we tried to pick them out.
And they were so. There was something totally different to what we thought they were.
Ah.
They provided light, they both had the same purpose.
It's different to what you thought they were. Meaning that what came first was the
assumption. We knew what they were.
Something you were looking for.
It was noticed first. You noticed, didn't you?
I saw them today, but I hadn't really examined them. I just saw yellow and made the assumption, oh, it's a Chanel candle.
Mm.
And we test, with plastic flowers, we might look at them, not be able to tell until we...
And that's what I did. I went to see if they... And it was, that's plastic.
Yeah.
And of course those lights are designed to look like they're a candle holder. And so they're meant to look that way.
Oh,
and therefore and therefore it's not entirely unreasonable to that you're trying to light them. So how we know, how we're able to determine differences in our sensory perception and what that means, of course. So here I have an experiment for you, and I'd like the four of you to come and... Yes,
Sensory perception, is this all about, you say?
If I told you what the experiment was about...
Oh, did you ask us to do something?
Corner, guys, I've got a corner.
Oh, wow. Look at you.
A straight piece.
Oh, look, are we supposed to make the puzzle?
Who knows?
Ah,
just
okay.
Go for it.
Then why don't we move the table slightly here and the light?
Oh, that's a good idea.
You can still be here.
The way I do it, I find all the straight pieces and the corners, put all the colours together that suit each other that might match.
So where's the straight piece?
Okay, then I just turn the things around. That's what I do.
Oh, Yeah, we need to have it the right way up so we can see the
colours. And I'll turn them around and I'll pass the straight there. And where's the
I found another side? Corner.
Oh, you're collecting the corners.
Well,
your job's done then.
No, because I need two more. But if anybody sees the corner, it'd be great.
Hold on, assuming it's a rectangle.
Yeah, that's true.
Assuming there is only one picture. There may be several.
Oh,
what pieces are going
together?
Oh, corner.
Hey, well.
Of course, this might not be the experiment.
That's not a corner. A corner is when you've got two straights.
Oh, I just saw a corner.
It's a straight piece.
There is a corner, though.
So, can you describe what you're doing right now?
We
are preparing to assemble the jigsaw.
Okay.
That's the long-term goal.
That's your intention, but what are you doing right now?
Sorting for straight pieces and corners.
Sorting. And why straight pieces and corners particularly?
They're the easiest things to
That's the way I was taught as a child to do a jigsaw.
Easiest. What makes it easiest?
Because you've got a frame.
You get your frame, yeah.
A frame. And what does the frame give you?
The perimeter, the space,
a boundary.
An organising principle.
An organising principle. An organising principle.
Oh, I've got a corner.
Yay!
A corner that goes with the straight bit.
Alright, what did you just do then?
Put two pieces together.
How did you know that they fitted together?
I looked at the colours and the patterns to see whether there was a match, and I looked at the shape.
So you're not just randomly trying to fit all the straight pieces together. You saw that there was some similarity. Looking at patterns.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Jump over.
And what are you first doing? What are you all aware of that you are first doing in looking for patterns?
I'm looking for colours and shades that might go together.
That go together.
Yeah.
So.
Tones that might.
Okay. Match. So if you were all looking for patterns and shapes that go together, what are you first identifying?
Well, for me, I'm just
similarities.
Yeah.
And then you're testing for similarities, and then you're seeing what?
All these questions are slowing me down, Peter.
Slowing you down from what?
From sorting and getting these pieces fitting together.
Well, you're the only person answering the questions. That might not be helpful.
I've answered a couple.
You have? So, I asked you all to come and take part in an experiment, yes?
Yes.
And I asked you to come to the table, yes?
Yes.
And did I tell you what to do at the table?
No.
So, what you're doing now is quite busy, it looks quite in advanced stages of whatever it is you're doing. Why are you doing it?
because that's what a jigsaw is for, is to put it together.
Okay, so you said that's what a jigsaw is for.
Yeah.
And Christine, you said...
I followed.
You followed what?
The lead, was it?
Was my thing. In the absence of instructions.
But do you like jigsaws, Julia?
I like jigsaws.
Because it's like, ooh. You know, like, ooh.
Could you complete that sentence, Julia, in the absence of instructions?
I saw a jigsaw in pieces and decided to start looking for the bits.
I've got this for you.
Decided to start looking for the bits?
Bits with straight edges that I might be able to fit together in order to make the whole.
In order to make the whole.
That there wasn't an instruction, another alternative would have been to ask for an instruction.
So how long have you been going before you're asking for the instruction? So you've been doing this for about 10 minutes now.
I questioned it, but didn't wait for an answer and just carried on doing what? The general...
What?
Peter?
Yeah?
What do you want us to do?
Exactly. Now, the other interesting thing I noticed is the if you've got a bunch of pieces there and you're sorting the pieces into groups, and those groups are based on similarity that you've said, that you're looking for similarity. So you've identified based on what? Because you've all seen jigsaw puzzles before. You said that's the way I was
taught as a child.
Mm. So you've all seen jigsaw puzzles before?
Yes.
So how did you know that there were straight pieces, edge pieces, corner pieces and so on?
Looked for them.
Before you even, as you came to the table, how did you know that they would be there?
Because
as an expectation.
We'd already learned that pattern of making jigsaws.
So you'd already learned
that. You could have taken out the...
I could have taken them all out, couldn't I?
Yeah, yeah.
That'd be interesting.
We would have found out. We would have realised.
So you would have been looking for what you expected.
Yeah.
And after a period of time, you declare that there are no straight pieces.
There may be more than one jigsaw, yeah.
So I don't know how many pieces are in this puzzle. It might be a thousand, a couple of thousand, and I can't remember what it said on the box. But
so we now know it's one jigsaw because it said, oh, it's on
the
one box.
Well, you start, and that was a question you asked earlier, that's a good point. Mm-hmm. So you started with the assumption that there would be straight edges.
Yes.
If I'd have taken all the straight edges out, how long do you think it would have taken before you said there are no straight edges in here, there are no corners?
A few minutes while I sorted them out and noticed that there was.
Would
no
you have looked at every piece?
Not every, because you know there's going to be quite a few straight pieces, that many pieces.
So your expectation is that you'd have found a straight or a corner by now?
Yes.
Yeah.
And therefore?
And that
there
might not be in
there. Excellent. Very good. And Patrick called all of this an organising principle.
Or
you're applying organising principles. And you are working, if I can make the observation, by identifying pieces that potentially will fit together, because you know that that's what you do with a jigsaw puzzle.
I also know that we all have our own agenda, because, for example, it was clear that Sue said she was looking for the corners, and Julia said she's looking for the straight line.
Yeah.
But now, Sue's got some straight line that Julia doesn't have.
Yes.
Maybe we should join up.
Maybe
we should swap positions.
Maybe Sue should swap place with me because I'm actually passing the straight line.
Oh, right, okay. But what I was thinking was, once we've got all the straight pieces in the corners, then you could be that side, I could be this side.
So that's interesting. So you're saying once you've got the straight pieces in the corners.
Yeah, we could join up together.
Yeah, and as we just heard, you've got a bunch of straight pieces there which Julia thinks she was collecting. Christine thinks she was helping Julia. Patrick's kind of commenting on the whole thing.
And turning them over like...
I did say I was looking for the straight pieces as well.
And simply turn them over to see what the pictures are. Now there are some jigsaws you can buy that have no picture on it, but they're just about fitting the pieces together.
Well, I mean, I'm not trying to group them as such, but I've noticed already that they are different colours and wording, sentences or words.
Caramels.
Caramels? What does that
have to do with? Sweet.
I've seen Cadbury's as well, Cadbury's chocolate.
I can give you this and that, which will fit.
In a minute, so we can swap over because we're getting towards the end of.
Can we swap over, Sue?
Well, what I meant was we can look at what colour. So I'm looking for purple and white writing. If you've got any of that, I would like some. So it looks like this.
When you first approached the table, what would you say was the sense, your sensory system that you were most most aware of?
Visual.
Mine was feeling, because my feeling was I love jigsaws.
Mine was.
And I was excited.
Mm. Visual and anticipation.
Should we decide which way around it's going to be, where our corners are going to be?
Now you've got a frame of reference, but that's not enough. Now you want to know which way up your frame of reference is.
Because it looks like that is that way up, and that's the corner there.
So that goes bottom right.
Okay, what is it that makes you think that should be that way up?
Have you got two corners?
I've got
top left.
I'm listening to what everyone's saying, rather than... Oh, jigsaw puzzle. Julia, say that again.
So the writing is dairy milk.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's...
That's very interesting. Is the writing dairy milk?
It's not, but it could be based on the fact that we've got caramels and something that suggests chocolate. So it could be.
So what actually are the letters that you can see?
Well, it's again, if we assume that the first one is a capital, and they all look like capitals, but there's no guarantee, it would be D, A, I, possibly R, and then M. Possibly I, possibly L, possibly K.
Great. And from that, you've added a bit of information based on your expectation, and even to the point that you didn't even know that you'd done it, and you said, this is dairy milk, which fit with your other expectations.
There. Other information.
Fantastic.
So it looks like it could be.
You've seen some hints of confectionery items, you've assumed that says dairy milk, and you've assumed that the letters give you a clue as to which way up that goes.
Now, where on the table are we putting is that the finished article over there or here?
What?
So there's one doing the bottom and one doing the top.
That's the bottom as well.
And that's the top.
So that looks like what's going on, Patrick. So who's doing the top?
Here's a side.
Julia's doing the top and doing the bottom.
So let me pause you again for a moment.
What about the sides?
So let me pause for a moment. Get you to reflect on what you're doing. So could you do a jigsaw with your eyes closed?
No. Oh, could you? If it was
practiced, possibly.
Maybe blind people have jigsaws with lumps on or something.
Probably not with this many pieces.
No.
What were the kind of jigsaws like that you had as a child?
Big, wooden, easy, very few.
Square. Yeah. And when you start doing them, are you doing them by thinking, right, by this method, or the first time, are you just randomly fitting together and trying to make things fit?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Without any thought.
Good.
Because I teach my granddaughter and she's just wanting to put anything together and going, well, look for the colours. Look what might fit with each other.
So would you say that stage is primarily a visual information that you're using? But now that you're starting to fit them together, it isn't just visual. It's you're getting a sense of touch as well, aren't you? Because you're fitting things and thinking, oh, no, that's not quite right.
Okay.
Now, go on.
Okay, I would say, Christine, what are you doing?
I'm just helping everybody else at the moment. I'm just, because when we
Do you know how to help them?
Well, all the straight edge ones I've been passing on to these. Now what I've noticed is that they're both working on different colours.
Okay, what I'm going to do then is to try to group them by colours.
And I'm kind of doing that as I go as well, because what I'm finding is that I'm able to multitask. So, as initially I was looking for just the straight edges, I'm now those colours the same way.
Just pause for a moment again.
It's
difficult. So Patrick asked Christine a very interesting question there, which was, how do you know that what you're doing is helping?
Because the aim, I'm helping, right, this is what I think tells me I'm helping is because the aim of Julia's and Sue's tasks, as I believe it to be, is to put the straight edges together. So when I find a star, I started off by...
Two, yes. You believe their intention is two. D do something, to achieve something.
Yeah.
Excellent.
So now
when you started, when all of you came to the puzzle, what was the first thing that you thought of when you saw the puzzle on the table, or parts?
I was confused.
Mm-hmm.
My first thought was, I wonder what we're going to do with this.
And do then, with, excellent, yes.
Yeah. And
yes.
Then Julia started it, I thought, oh yeah, I'll join in because I love doing jigsaws.
Good, good. So your intention is that faced with all these parts that you recognise what they are, is you know what the end result is going to be. You don't know what the picture is, but you know the end result is going to be some completed puzzle, yes?
Yeah.
And so you all started thinking about to make, to sort, to get. Do you think there'll come a point in time when you'll move away from what you, the puzzle you want to create, and you'll start looking for gaps? Maybe I should have got a puzzle with fewer pieces in hindsight.
Yeah, I guess the so we're working independently primarily, I think. There's a little
yes.
bit of independently, but I imagine there would come a point where we've got a sort of maybe a rough frame, and then we're all starting to contribute to the one thing that is
right.
I would imagine.
And then you might be looking for what's missing rather than where do I put
yes.
the rest? What do we
yes.
achieve?
Yeah, that would be different.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Very good. I think I'll get a smaller puzzle for next time. I just like the picture
that
was on this one. I have. I just really like the picture that was on this one.
It's chocolate.
Oh, yeah.
Now, how do you all know? How do you all know what this thing is supposed to look like?
We don't. We're making an assumption that it's a rectangular or square.
Well, if
mm-hmm.
we.
Yeah.
Follow the pattern, then a pattern will emerge, which
excellent.
Will then give us the clue as to.
Oh,
so if you follow this pattern of putting
oh,
the pieces together.
Yeah, it's not this bit here.
Listen to what Christine just said.
Sorry,
say that again, Christine.
If we follow the pattern of what we've learned, then the pattern will become evident.
So by following this focus of attention and fitting these pieces together at this small level, then another level of information arises.
Mm.
And is that going to arise all in one go? Based on what you've seen so far, are you just going to keep on fitting these pieces together until the whole picture emerges? Or is something else going to happen in between? Is something else already happening?
I'm talking about sleep. Cool.
We're starting to get a sense of random bits that are, it's about sweets or chocolate, so there's a subject matter possibly arising.
Yes, and you said there's a Snickers, there's a Dairy Milk.
A marathon, I think that A and L might be a Coca-Cola-y type thing, maybe, possibly.
Okay.
So
we don't just go from the individual components straight up to the whole picture.
Yeah.
We've got these, and then we've got patterns within the big pattern. A pattern of a Snickers, a pattern of a Dairy Milk.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question? I mean, Julia, I think you all quite like chocolate, don't you?
Yeah, I love chocolate.
Can I add, is that adding to the, even though it's not real chocolate, is it adding to the anticipation of wanting to?
No. Because I don't like sweets, I just like really dark chocolate, so sweets and marathons and things.
What about you?
No, I like the fact that it's going to be easier to put together because we'll have words and the colours are easier to find the patterns.
That's interesting.
That might be part
of it. That's interesting. So would it be as good if it were just...
I also think it's not sequential. You see a pattern, then you come back to the beats, and it's all about building a pattern, okay, I mean a picture, but you keep testing your theory and going back and forth between the territory and the map you're creating.
Now, did you notice what Patrick just gave you there?
That was brilliant.
Back and forth between
that. He says you start with this, then you look for this, then you do this, and then this, and then this, and then this, and then this. He gave you a sequence. He gave you a procedure. And Sue, you described a procedure earlier. First you look for the corners, and you look for the straight edges, and then you do this, and then you do this. You give them procedures. you know how to do a jigsaw.
So is that another word for a rule?
Not an individual rule, but a sequence of rules, a sequence of steps is a procedure. It's like how to get from your house to a place in Manchester.
Good idea.
And I'm making an assumption that it's one picture.
Yes.
It could be more than one.
Well, that was one of my first thoughts. We may have more than one here.
So what would happen?
And we'd find that out by just...
So far, we've noticed some interesting patterns, not on the table, patterns in your behaviour, that you were looking primarily at first. You were trying to get to something, trying to achieve something. You're following patterns, procedures that you've learned because this is a familiar task. So you know the sequence of steps to go through. You don't just start randomly grabbing pieces and see if they fit together. You've looked for groupings based on similarities of shape,
colour,
and now similarities of colours, assuming that if they're similar, they must somehow go together. And you've started with the bits and assembling the patterns of the bits. Then a second level of information comes out of that, and then when you assemble those second levels, you get another level of information. So what do you think might change if I were to...
He's going to give us the picture. He's going to give us the box.
What do you think might happen if I showed you what that top level of information was? Do you think that would make it easier or harder?
Easier.
You ready?
Much easier.
Oh my goodness. Okay.
Okay, for first impression, did that make it easier or harder?
It looked complicated.
Well,
I think it's easier.
So you're expecting it to be easier, and it actually looked harder because?
Because it's very busy.
I didn't feel that. I thought it was easier.
If I show you that, that now easier or harder? Okay. So based on that, tell me where, roughly in the picture, the after eights were.
Oh, only if you leave me with the picture.
Oh, you want to leave it with
Yes.
You?
I don't want you to just show me that and that's it.
Did you even know there were after eights yet?
No.
So what do you think you've got? What do you think you've got? What's something that you think you've got so far, this kind of second level pattern? What you're calling, oh, there's a sweet that I recognise.
Marathon.
A marathon, right. Let's see where the
We've got fruit
is.
And nut.
Let's go with marathon. Marathon is towards the at the top, towards the right.
Top right, okay.
Is that helpful?
Yep.
And we've got fruit and nut.
How is that helpful?
Because I know that I can put that there is roughly going to be there in relationship to the rest of the picture, assuming that we're going with the same dimensions.
Okay, and what is that now, what difference does that make, you've been able to do that?
Because that's a more sure piece of information, a more secure piece of information, than not knowing whether actually the marathon was down the side.
And what's interesting is, I've told you where the marathon is.
Did you just say down the side?
Oh, you might tell us a lie.
Oh, but we didn't see it.
But you didn't see it for yourself. Mm.
So we're trusting your information and you're transcribing and visual into auditory.
It's not first hand, is it?
Yeah.
So how do you know the marathon belongs top right?
Because I'm decoding what you're saying and putting a meaning on it and investing it with truth.
Yes.
And accuracy.
Yes.
And then translating that into a...
So what would make you more certain?
So we can see the picture again. Okay, talk truth.
Okay, excellent. Okay.
Is that more or less helpful?
More helpful, because I could see what was on the other side of it.
Ah, what was on the other side. So now you've got a context for it. Because I said it was at the top towards the right.
Yeah.
That's quite vague.
It is, yes. Which is helpful.
Yeah. But the context was more helpful.
Yeah.
So when you looked at where the marathon was for yourself, you weren't looking really at where it was, you were looking for what's around it.
Yes.
Interesting. What am I talking about? What are all these things that I'm commenting? What am I talking about?
the details.
Process.
And not just the process, but something else about processes.
An organising principle.
I'm reflecting on the patterns, the processes that you're following. That you're following consistently, that are predetermined. That you knew before you even came to the table and saw what was on it. And the instant you saw something that fitted into those organising principles, you started behaving in pursuit of a goal. Even though you didn't know what that goal was in detail. And me showing you a picture of the goal didn't even help. You'll notice that.
Yeah.
Go on.
I wouldn't say that seeing the picture doesn't help, because it give me a general information about how the elements are organised. So it's not
excellent.
Like...
So if I show you the picture,
yeah,
can you tell me where that piece goes?
No.
Right. So no. How does it help?
Well, it helps at another level.
Orientation.
It's not to do with... it's at another level.
So what's wrong with asking you to locate that piece in that picture? Or what's difficult about that?
Because you have no way of...
No frame of reference.
It's random in terms of how you would have to go. You would have to go colour.
We could have some guesses.
You can have a go.
Yeah.
I think it's... It's an M and it's brown as a colour, so it's...
Brown, it's purple.
It's blue, isn't it?
It's purple.
Oh, you see...
Brown, purple,
thing going
blue.
On now, and yeah.
That's interesting.
So everyone sees...
White, bright, writing.
Milk.
And is that an M? Or is that a W?
It's an M.
Yeah.
It's white, writing, or...
Does it make it harder or easier when I move the piece further away from the picture?
It doesn't make any difference because...
Does it make
any difference? We organise...
So if I take that away now,
yeah,
you remember that in sufficient detail to find it?
No. Yeah. I'd like to keep looking at it.
Yes.
So yes, for you,
like
no for you.
No.
You reckon you can find it?
And would that be when you test
it's
the tote?
It's a purple background.
I know where it is.
Oh.
You know where it is?
No.
No.
Okay.
And what are you doing?
I'm eliminating and...
Eliminating?
Yeah.
Excellent. Faced with too much information, you started by eliminating. Excellent.
There's an M here on a dark background.
Oh, it's blue, not brown.
It's here,
yeah.
It's here.
Cream. Yes, that's it.
Yeah.
That is one.
Yeah. So faced with too much information, you first eliminate it to reduce the complexity.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Excellent. Very good. What do you think I'm talking about in NLP terms?
You're talking about tort.
No.
As well. Well.
Well, there are tones operating
the,
here.
Yeah, and patterns.
No.
It patterns.
When we talk about these patterns, these organising principles.
Generalisations.
These patterns you already had before
strategies.
You even saw what was on the table. Yes, there are strategies in here, but there's something else in NLP that, if I say, for example, that you are aiming to build the puzzle rather than avoid something or get away from something. If I say that you are...
A program, to order away.
Yes, and we call that a metaprogram.
Or a filter.
Yes. A metaprogram is an organising principle, an organising pattern for our perceptions, which makes us predisposed to look at information in a certain way. However, that doesn't mean that we're predisposed to look at all information in that way, but things that we identify as certain types of information, or in this case, a certain challenge or a certain puzzle. So visual, the first one, was that you looked rather than listening. soon as you saw and invited you to the table, you almost straight away you got stuck in. So you wanted to do something. And actually this fits into Kolb's experiential learning theory, for those of you familiar with that. The first thing you wanted to do was active experiment. Do something. Have a primary first-hand sensory experience. Once you've got that experience, what do you want to do with that?
Organise it.
Organise it, yes.
Yeah.
Which is the second stage of Kolb's experiential learning cycle, which is reflective observation.
Yeah.
What just happened? What did I do? What did I learn? What do we then do once we've organised that experience?
Look for patterns?
Yes, we form a theory.
Yeah.
So we form what's called an abstract concept in Kolb. We look for patterns. We have an expectation of what we're going to do and what we look for. And then, what do?
We test
that theory by looking for straight bits, looking for bits that fit together, looking for bits that are the same colour. And then we're back to active experiment again, because now you've done something, and then you reflect. So that's an organising principle, that if we don't have an experience, we've got nothing to reflect on, so that kind of makes sense. So, what about your frame of reference? You can either focus on yourself internally, I just know, or external, look for external information. And you just know that this is a puzzle and what to do with it. But then as soon as you start looking for edges, that's exactly what you're doing, you're building a frame of reference. And you're asking, which way up does it go? And at the start, you were making the assumption, I'm guessing, at this stage, it doesn't really matter which way up it goes, let's just get it.
We've got straight bits.
And then that will tell us which way up it goes.
Yes.
If we see blue at the top and green at the bottom, the blue is probably sky, that's probably at the top.
So internal reference, external reference, they're shifting.
They're going backwards and forwards, yes. Because we're gathering information and we're checking it.
Yeah.
Gathering and checking it. So again, people I've seen come off practitioner courses and they say, oh, I'm an internal person. Okay, get back in the cupboard then. It doesn't mean anything to say I'm a visual person, I'm an internal person. It doesn't mean anything. It's within a context. Your focus of attention is by taking data and the point of reference is internal. And then you run out of your own experience, and so the point of reference becomes external again, and it shifts between the two.
Also, I know I keep bringing a personal element into this, but something that started clicking into place for me in the last couple of days is that I'm a visual person, and one of the things that enforced that was all the training that I've done.
Yes.
What I've actually done is I've focused all my attention on kinesthetic, visual, and the one skill that I probably would have gained more from focusing from is the listening skill.
And yet you have, because this is the interesting thing. We don't experience life looking forwards, we experience it looking backwards. We only get those levels of learning from listening to the audio that we've been listening to, by listening to it over and over again. We can't make sense of it going forwards. We can only make sense of it by having an experience and then reflecting back. This puzzle doesn't make sense as a bunch of pieces on a table. The puzzle only makes sense when
we solve it.
When it's complete, yes.
When it's complete, yeah.
So we can only get to the end of experience and then look back in order to learn. We can't learn forwards, we learn backwards. Because part of an intrinsic part of that learning cycle is the reflective observation. We can only do that after we've had an experience.
It's a good taught thing. It's a good. When you were talking about the taught and you were using that circuit board and everything, I had a fleeting thought about a jigsaw analogy with it, and because you're checking all the time, you know, with. Sorry, am I just totally off sync there?
Are you?
I don't know.
You're right, you're checking, constantly checking.
Yeah.
So you have a way of knowing what colour that is and what that means. You have a way of comparing that one to that one. And when I said, for the sake of argument, if we take
that person check too much?
Well, that's what Patrick was showing us when he was going eliminating. There's too much information. So here's another piece. And if I say this piece, if we locate that within the picture, where is that? What's the first thing we'd be doing? What do you... Cool. Okay. Oh, you want to turn it?
I'm not sure which way around it goes.
Right, okay.
That's
going
to make sense. I'll go for there.
Well,
now, what's the first obvious thing that I can see you all doing?
Comparing.
Looking from one to the other. And when you compare, you cannot look at both at the same time. Mm. Yes?
Mm. So what Patrick did was take some qualities from that he picked up.
Yes.
And then...
Yes. He reduced the information in this one down to colour only. And he reduced the information here by looking to sort it out, to remove anything that didn't have that colour. Now, if you compare two objects, you cannot look at them both at the same time. Yes? So what do you do when your eyes move from this one to this one? What's in your mind?
You're either looking for the similarity of the colour with that, or you're looking for the other things that are different to get rid of them.
Yes. And therefore this, as soon as you look at this to compare, this is now not in reality, this is in your memory. And you're projecting this onto here.
Yeah.
And therefore that is now subject to distorting, to
yes.
distortions.
So what I, yeah.
Like it's brown or it's purple.
That's what I did with the first one. My memory was, and my coding was, purple translated to this. Actually it wasn't. So that, so no, I was looking for the wrong thing.
Colour.
That was, yeah.
Yeah.
So that was distorted.
So as soon as we compare, the object of the comparison automatically is now no longer external. It's become internal. Because we can't look at both at the same time, and as soon as it becomes internal, it's in the past, and it's subject to deletions, distortions, and generalizations. So the comparison will always contain what we were talking about yesterday, when we were talking about perfectionists. So the comparison, because now, as soon as you look at this, this is now held in your memory, and therefore is subject to deletions, distortions, and generalizations, and therefore, will always be subject to something we talked about yesterday when we talked about perfectionists.
Is it that you can't complete the loop because, no?
You remember we talked about measuring the perfectionist has changed from what you said, from what we discussed yesterday.
If we think about measuring against that standard meter, and I said we can never ever recreate something that is exactly the same length as the standard meter.
Yeah.
Because? Because we lack the ability to measure accurately enough. And if we could measure down to the length of a single atom, then there would always be a margin of error of an atom's width.
Yeah.
Because we can't see any smaller than the smallest unit of measurement. Therefore, your ability to find this piece in this picture will always be hindered by that margin of error. You can find pieces that are close enough to this. Isn't this what you did with the piece that you found up in this one?
Yeah.
You started looking for colours that are similar. You found a couple. Oh, no, that's not it. So you thought it was it within the margin of error, and then you found it.
Yeah.
But then when you keep checking back and looking at it, that margin of error gets less.
Gets smaller because we're checking and testing, and the margin of error reduces, and that's what we do.
But, like when you ask me to throw the ball at the beginning of the week, and I ask you how far is it, you said it's 8 flings.
Yes.
And I thought, I could determine what 8 flings is, but I thought I can only make sense of it if, you know, with the next one. And actually, I don't need to know what a flings is. Because as long as I've got...
getting smaller or bigger.
Smaller or bigger, so...
Assuming
that
flims work that way.
Excuse me, what's a flim?
Well...
It's a made-up unit of measurement.
Oh, right.
Designed to
like an ant.
Make it impossible for Patrick to calibrate.
Yeah.
Well, I thought of that, but then I thought, for example, I was not thinking about, sorry, I was thinking, are you moving the target, which would make, you know, the whole exercise a lot more complicated.
Yes.
And, you know, that's what you do, so you, I mean, it's, that's what I did. So I try to see what I can do. I can organize the experience and then think, is there some coherence? Is there a relation between the result I get with, you know, what I feel I was doing?
Mm. And given the complexity of your servo system, you're more than capable, given enough time, of correcting for both the location of the target and the fact that the target moves over time. Because if you couldn't, you wouldn't be able to catch a ball. Or hit a tennis ball.
If it was random and I have no way of measuring
any kind of pattern,
then it would become luck.
Yeah, and if there's any kind of pattern, you would, given enough time, be able to correct for that.
But yeah.
And next one.
With a jigsaw as well, sometimes you might have two pieces that are very, very similar, that actually with a little bit of force you could.
Yes.
Convince yourself it
fits.
Yes.
Good. Good. Mm. Good point. And therefore, you might have two pieces that are so similar, your margin of error doesn't allow you to tell the difference. So, everybody, listen to what Christine is saying, because this is very important. She said, there might be two pieces that are so similar, you think they fit together, but they really don't.
Mm.
So your margin of error for the visual is not sufficient to allow you to correct for that difference.
Yeah.
So then you have to rely on a different measurement system. So what do you do?
Well, based on my experiences of doing that with a jigsaw is, I usually don't realise that till it's kind of near the end. Uh-huh. So then it's a case of starting and looking for the right piece, take that one out, find the one that does fit.
Yes. And isn't that like doing a crossword puzzle where you're convinced a word is right?
Yes.
And you're changing all the other words to fit a word that you think is right. And after hours of labouring over it, you realise that that starting word was wrong.
Mm.
Yeah.
Or you could be right, and yet it's not enough.
It's not
the right word.
Because I had a client with OCD.
Yeah.
I solved the OCD, and yet it didn't work. It didn't make any sense.
What didn't work?
Well, the
how you didn't
just focusing on the OCD. Mm-hmm. That worked. I mean, that was solved, but it would still come back at the, you know, and redo it. So it was like, that part was repaired, yet there was something that made it, you know, reappear.
Yeah.
Ah, so
it was putting it back again.
Yeah.
Which we're all quite capable of doing. You can do a fantastic practitioner technique with somebody, and they're quite capable of going and putting things right back the way they were, because there's some higher or preceding driver that we've not taken into account. Mm.
Can I just say something else?
Yes.
The I'll talk about the jigsaw example. I thought that Patrick was looking for patterns or turning them all over. And I thought if he found a straight piece, he would give it either to me or Julia. But he didn't. He kept them in this pile, which stopped us from being able to put the pieces together. So keeping back information, even if he didn't know he was, or maybe he did it on purpose, I don't know.
Well, look what's happened here. What do you see here?
Well, I keep feeding, you know, what seems to fit together. I've got the yellow here, I've got the orange.
Yes.
Sue and me who are trying to do the edges, and there's Christine and Patrick who are trying to sort for sort of general.
Now what's interesting here is these are all sorted together on what criteria?
Colour.
Which is, colour is?
Orange, red, orange.
Okay, So we're assuming that because they're all the same colour, they all belong in the same place. Look again at where the red pieces are.
Yeah, they're all over the place.
They're actually all over.
Yeah.
Yes.
But we wouldn't know that without having seen that. So we might conclude that without having seen the picture. But once we've seen the picture...
However, it's going towards...
Yes.
The...
Because you could sort within that then, couldn't you? You could look at, okay, that's a big letter, that's a big letter.
Yeah.
That's a, you could sort within the sort.
Yeah, you're saying that's a big letter, that's a big letter,
So you've got a bit of yellow there, you've got a bit of yellow.
So does that belong there?
Clearly not.
Clearly not.
Clearly not.
So you started sorting for similarity.
Yeah.
And then the next piece you pick is different.
You picked.
Yeah, so I picked one that I hoped you would say, about that one, the same sort of colour. Does that belong?
No.
Well, that's the next step.
This is an orange with white lettering, and this is a white with orange lettering. So it's the opposite.
What's interesting?
But steel.
As I suspect, it does belong.
It could do, yeah.
Because
it could be.
Yeah,
but
you don't know that
until
you've tested it. Okay.
Mac in the
bottom
munches, yeah, it is.
Isn't it?
Oh, I love that.
Now, isn't that interesting?
So by finding similarities.
But still, when you've got the letters, like here, for example, here I've got two, which I don't know what they are, but the lettering are the same, so they belong together. And I'm looking for the same type of lettering, and it's already easier because I've got all the yellow here.
So sorting for a general similarity makes it easier to sort for a specific similarity.
Yeah.
Okay, I'd like you all to stop doing the puzzle for a moment and shift your focus to commenting on metaprograms. So if we take the first one, visual, auditory or kinesthetic. Is this entirely visual?
No.
Focus?
Visual.
Not entirely.
Visual, there's some kinesthetic, and
there's
some listening to what others are saying.
So how do you know which one of those is preferable at any moment in time?
Well, for the little role I'm playing, it's visual. I'm looking for colours.
Uh-huh. And are you ignoring what people are saying?
No.
In case it confuses you, or you're listening to what people are saying, and is that influencing you?
Well, I've kind of been listening to the kind of been listening.
Mm.
So I haven't had my full attention on the listening.
So your attention has been mainly on the visual?
On the visual and looking, and visual, because I've been observing what the others are doing, listening to what they were doing.
Okay, so any moment in time, how do you know, and this question for all of you, how do you know whether to attend to what you see versus what you hear versus what you feel?
Well, you should do all, shouldn't you?
But how do you know which you're attending to at any moment in time?
How do you know?
Self-focused attention, is it?
What you focus on at that time.
And what you focus on at that time, and what makes you focus on that at that time.
Your intention.
Your intention.
The necessity.
The necessity, which we could describe as the bigger
picture.
The bigger frame of reference.
We hear somebody saying, oh, I've got a da da da, or like Sue said, I've got that corner. I think it's, so we then, that takes preference over what I'm doing on the table, which is to find bits with lines. So I guess there's a valuing of that's more important than that I listen to that than that I keep finding square bits.
Excellent.
For that moment.
So internal versus external. So the difference is that with internal, it's what you already know and what already have experienced that is the reference source. External, what is new, what is outside of yourself is the reference source.
Mm-hmm.
So it's where you're making comparisons, what you're holding as the reference standard. So at times, we've talked about your focus is internal, and at times it's external, we talked about that shifting. But how do you know, what is it you think that causes your focus to be internal versus external at any point in time?
Well,
Is it external input and then a response to that?
What was the very first thing that you came to the table? The very first thing that happened was what?
You looked at it.
You looked at it. So it was already there.
Yeah.
So that's an external.
Okay.
And then as soon as you looked at it, what was the next thing?
You thought about the next thing.
You thought, and that's an internal.
Yes.
And there's this cycle going on. Now, as soon as you started assembling pieces and, you know, collecting corners and so on, your focus is on what you expect to find. You expect there to be corners. And so your reference, is that internal or external? Internal,
it's internal,
because you're expecting to find them.
It's not there.
And you're looking for them. Now, if I'd have hidden all the corners, which I might try next time, that sounds kind of
funny. Thought you'd have hidden the fourth one, actually.
If I'd have hidden,
I thought you'd be more than one
corners
on leveled up.
Right. If I'd hidden, I don't know, mate, it's not a trick, so I'm not trying to, you know, catch you out. So if I'd hidden all the corners in the straight lines, then your reference is going to shift from internal for what you're looking for to what?
That's external. So you
have
to see what you've done with them.
So we
have first of all, external to what's happening in the puzzle. You're looking for what you expect to find.
Yes.
And when you don't find it, then you become aware, hang on a minute, you're more aware then of what is actually on the table rather than what you're looking for on the table. Now, there's a metaprogram about choice, which is options versus procedures. So, how would you define an options metaprogram?
I've got a question on that.
Can I ask what that metaprogram, options versus choice?
Procedures.
Procedures. Options versus procedures.
Well, everybody kind of has the overall frame of procedure in terms of how to do a puzzle. Yeah. But there was no convergence towards having the procedure for everyone. So everybody went into options, into well, they're doing this, I'm doing my own thing.
Mm-hmm.
And there is complementarity in the sense that, okay, I've got a sense that Sue is knowing what she does, so does Julia. And therefore, I'm thinking, how would I be most useful in terms of being complementary?
What causes that complementarity, as you described it?
Comparison?
To?
Deletion, you delete what's already been done.
Well, you've got four individuals, each doing different tasks, which are roughly complementary. What is it that causes those tasks to be complementary?
Well, because
we focus on getting the jigsaw completed. The goal, the intention, which sets a...
Yeah, a procedure versus a sequence.
Yeah. There's only so many different ways you can put a jigsaw puzzle together.
Yeah.
But there's only one way it can
together. Overall, there is a procedure, but within that, there are also, you know, slight room of maneuvering to argue.
You could have started with the colour group.
Yeah.
You could have started with the corners, you could have started with the edges, you could have started with things you could identify as writing.
We could have asked you for the picture.
You could have asked me for the picture and you didn't. Yes. So these are all possibilities about.
So sometimes the obvious isn't always obvious.
Right.
At the corner, we would not start it without the picture.
Yes, and it becomes unobvious because.
Oh, God.
It becomes unobvious because.
Because now we know.
Because you know. And so the moment you engage in the procedure and that becomes your focus, the other options disappear. There is nothing else to look for apart from corners or edges or common colours. So as soon as you identify the frame of reference and you start down that route, you're on that route. And what we saw that was interesting doing it as a group exercise is we saw some different permutations about where to start with the puzzle, all of which are valid, all of which would have created the completed puzzle as an end result. But we saw the group operating as the options level, and we saw the individuals operating at the procedures level.
also made assumptions.
Yes.
I assumed that we weren't allowed the picture. I thought about it. I thought, but if we could have the picture, it would be here.
And that has an interesting connection between what we talked about when we did your group coaching exercise. Am I allowed to get a drink?
Yeah.
Am I allowed to look at the book to turn around?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
And I didn't ask, am I allowed to have the picture?
No, you just assumed that
it's couldn't not have allowed it because it wasn't here.
Yeah. Did any of you look around for the box? Did you even do that?
No.
Didn't even look for the box.
No, again, I assumed you'd hid it.
It might have been sat there and you...
I assumed it was part of it. Because that's part of our job when we're working with people to find the pattern because the thought
and
that
you assumed start, the frame of reference yes. and that immediately yeah. constrained yeah. your behaviour and your choices. Yeah.
If we'd have asked for the box then, would you have given it?
If you'd have asked for the picture?
You could have given us a picture that wasn't the right picture.
But would you have given it? I'm just interested. Or would you have said Because of the process you wanted us to go through, would you have denied us having the picture?
Probably, for a bit.
Yeah.
Probably.
Which is why my assumption was right.
Yeah.
But that isn't why your assumption was right, because you didn't then know that that would have happened.
No.
Because what I'm considering is, would I have given you the picture, and how would that have biased or changed the result?
Yes.
And would you have learned... would there then have been less for us to reflect on?
Yes.
Because this whole thing that's happening is experiment, reflect, form a theory, test the theory.
Cool. Yeah.
I've got a question. We've got this as the metaphor.
Yeah.
And you said a short while ago that you could have took the corners out, you could have took the edges out.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, so then what we might have done is we'd have then gone on to thought looking for the patterns here. But we would never, it would have been harder to get a clear picture. And without these corners and lines, we wouldn't have a framework. And I'm analogizing that with the coaching thing. So if we missed out on one important thing, we could still do the rest of the jigsaw, but we wouldn't have the edges and it'd be a bit...
And then how would you know that it was complete?
Yeah.
If you started from the middle and worked out, how would you know that the puzzle was complete?
We have the full picture.
So if I'd have hidden all the straight edges, if you'd have started from the middle and worked out,
yes.
How would you have known when the puzzle was complete?
Because we'd
run out of pieces.
We know that
when we'd have compared it with that.
When you run out of pieces.
But I still, if I had all jagged edges, because of my experience, I know that it needs an edge. I would have said, it's not complete, have you got the edges?
So, the point, and Christian is quite right in saying that if you started from the middle and worked out, there were no straight edges,
yeah.
you still reach an edge,
yeah.
it just isn't straight.
Yeah.
How do you know there aren't more pieces to go on the outside?
Yes.
And therefore, how you know when you're finished is when?
When you run out of pieces.
When you run out of pieces.
I think my personal inclination was, I was not bothered about seeing the overall picture because it reduces your options in terms of, you know, if you see that, then you are compulsed to do that.
So you made a choice that allowed you to keep more options available to you.
Yeah.
Excellent. Very good. So the next metaprogram, sameness versus difference, similarity versus difference.
Oh, well.
So you're grouping based on?
Similarity.
Yeah.
And I was thinking Patrick's, I'm looking for the colour and then taking out anything.
Casting
out of what didn't fit with that colour.
Yeah.
Oh, another quick look.
Yeah.
Like I put all the blue here together. Yes. And so there's blue, but there is different shade of blue. So
that will be
you know, then you go.
So we have sameness in a category,
and then difference
between categories.
Yeah.
And even within a category, we have sameness and difference.
Yeah.
And even within all the pieces that make up a marathon bar, there are differences because they're different pieces.
Mm.
But we arbitrarily group those pieces into that's a marathon. Now, we've got something here that says Cadbury fruit and nuts, it looks like.
Nuts!
Sorry.
Question.
Oi, nuts.
Ooh.
Question for you all. Is that a Cadbury fruit and nut bar?
It doesn't look like it because it's not purple.
Unless it's an old.
It's an old, this is 19.
Ah, yeah, so they've changed colours.
60s, I think, these 1960s.
So I have a frame of reference from today's Cadbury's fruit.
That's where, you know, the more.
It's not a long.
I call it purple, you call it blue. That's weird.
Well,
so what about this one? It's more obvious. Is it
marathon?
Is that a marathon?
Yes.
Yes.
Is that a marathon bar?
That was a representation of a fragment of a picture of a marathon bar.
Thank you. Do you hear how we automatically generalise?
Mm.
That's a marathon bar.
Ah, yes. Well,
I'd like to see
that.
You eat it. So, similarity and difference. You're sorting for one, and then you're sorting for the other. We saw Patrick start with difference and reduce the amount of information. And we've seen you looking for similarity, starting with similarity in order to create categories. And what are you doing by creating categories? If you step back and look at what you've done in creating categories, what have you achieved?
You're narrowing it.
Go on.
Narrowing it down.
What do you mean by narrowing it down?
You reduce the scope.
Reduce the scope
tidying
in order to
what? Tidying it up so that.
What did we
you're
say?
Looking at the patterns.
Yeah. What did we say the other day about the reason why it's counterproductive for people to imagine their goal as being something big and fantastic, exciting, and really vivid and colourful? And why was that counterproductive? Remember the self-help guru is getting you to imagine yourself in your most fantastic life when you've got yachts and your
really.
Because
a goal is a series of steps.
Really. Because a goal is a series of steps. And if we create an outcome that is too far away from the present state, any servo system cannot correct and will run out of control or do nothing. And therefore that's counterproductive because it's too far away and we can't figure out how to get there.
Mm.
So just everybody stop and just step back. What do you see now that's different to what you first saw when you approached the table?
It's much bigger. Mm-hmm. So it was a clump, and now it's spread.
Uh-huh.
There's a pattern developing.
Yeah.
There's a lots of different patterns.
Yeah. Yeah, what did you say, sorry?
Lots of different patterns.
Different.
Within a pattern.
Within a pattern. Different patterns within a pattern. Excellent. Do you see patterns within what it looks at first glance like it's still quite random, and yet do you see patterns within it now?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Whilst we were doing it, I said to Joey, I feel like an ant. I've been watching ants.
Yeah.
And
each ant,
they work together.
Each ant doesn't know what it's doing. It just does what it's designed to do.
Right.
But then we see these complex behaviours emerging from the interaction of all of those components. So the final metaprograms talk about is general versus specific. And we've seen this process of categorization, creation of these different levels. You can buy jigsaw puzzles that have thousands of pieces and they're all the same colour. Or they have an abstract pattern on them. And there's like the hardest puzzle in the world, I think it's called, something like that. And they're double-sided as well. So you don't even know which way up. It's not even blank on the back. And they're for people who are really into jigsaw puzzles.
And there's
was jigs. Yeah, and there's those three-dimensional ones. So if we say there's only two levels of complexity, there's that level of the individual piece, and there's the complete picture, and there's nothing in between. Is that harder or easier than what you've done here?
Harder.
Because what you're able to do here is categorize at levels of complexity. The highest level is that picture, that's general. The lowest level is an individual component, that's specific. But it isn't just one or the other. We've got multiple levels of in-between.
Mm-hmm.
And what we're able to do is expand and condense our frame of reference. As you say, a frame is starting to emerge, that's allowing you to make meaning and to make groupings in order to resolve the puzzle. So, from your experience of this exercise, this experiment, what have you learned about metaprograms?
You dive in and out of them. You don't operate from one all the time.
Okay. And therefore, we wouldn't necessarily say, oh, that he's an optionless person.
Yes. My experience would be that some people prefer to work in certain ways. So there's a sort of a tendency to be internally referenced or externally referenced, but it's not a permanent. It's not a this is. Person runs this pattern, full stop.
Okay, so without a clear starting point or a clear frame of reference, a person might default to a pattern of behaviour.
Yeah. Mm.
Always start with the corners.
And it depends what you're measuring as well, because you could say, oh, it's mainly procedural, but within that it could be all options, or it's options, but within that it's all procedural. So it depends what scope of what you're looking at.
Yes, that once we've selected an option, we're in procedures, and therefore that's about frame of reference rather than a definitive description of what that person's doing.
Yeah.
I like to think of it like with the analogy of cooking, but an options approach would be to say, what ingredients do I have and what can I make with it? And a procedures approach would be to say, what do I want to make? What does the recipe call for? Have I got it? And actually, we all do both, don't we? Sometimes we start with a recipe, I want to make eggs, oh, I haven't got any eggs, I have to make something else.
Yeah.
Sometimes we start with, what can I throw together in order that's going to fulfill certain criteria that's going to be edible and so on.
And that's why you never got the same sangria.
That's why you never got the same sangria. Yeah.
That was the options.
Yeah, options.
What else? What have you learned about metaprograms during this experiment?
Some work, an explanation that you were giving came to mind, and I had to check the book to see what it was, and I walked and it's actually at the beginning, it's not in the metaprogram things. I don't know if this is the right answer, but it's just jumping in the face. The map is not the territory, is it? Or the territory is not the map?
Mm-hmm. How does that apply here? What is causing Julia's compulsion to complete the puzzle?
Compulsion being your word. Julia's intrigue or Julia's fascination. Compulsion is your word.
How do we define a compulsive behaviour?
It's to tidy up. Well, it's a stuck, a repeated.
I'm in my own compulsive behaviour, I'm still writing my notes.
Yes.
Well, it's to do with no choice, basically. It comes to a point where the tension builds and she saw something and she has to, you know.
And so what I've observed multiple times is Julia stepping out of whatever we're doing in order to continue with the puzzle. And what I've observed Sue doing is taking notes, and what I've observed Patrick doing is stepping back and making observational comments, and what I've observed Christine doing is dipping in and out in order to check what she's learning and check whether she's got it right. So what does that say about what's going on here?
We all act in our own patterns of behaviour. We run it over and over again.
So what is your... You had a common intention created by the frame of reference that I created, which is a bunch of puzzle pieces on a table, that you assumed were from the same puzzle and would form one picture and so on, and that I haven't, you know, made it difficult for you or anything like that. But now outside of that, we have another level of intention. And Sue, what is your intention in taking notes?
To remember everything that I'm learning.
And Christine, what's your intention in going back and checking the book and asking questions and helping other people and what you've been doing?
To learn. To, I'm actually learning in many different ways at the moment. I'm learning the subjects of what we're here to learn. And I'm also adjusting myself as I go to how I can learn better. So there's lots, quite a lot going on, really.
Julia, what's your intention in periodically going back to the puzzle?
Partly to give my body something to do whilst I'm listening, so I'm not just standing, and partly intrigued to see whether I can do it and whether I can figure it out.
Excellent. Yeah. Patrick, what's your objective in stepping back and observing and commenting as you have been?
Understanding, and also because I had more time to reflect on. I think it's about improving my relationship to the world.
Excellent. And what's my intention, appear to be, to you, in the commentary that I've provided so far, and the questions that I've asked?
To teach us. To get us thinking, to learn experientially.
Okay. So what have you observed, what patterns have you observed in my behaviour?
Asking questions?
What kind of questions?
NLP questions?
Open questions. Related to the processes that we are unconsciously acting out.
Yes, and therefore questions designed to do what?
To elicit.
Elicit conscious awareness of the different programs that we're all running.
Yes, and to focus your attention. And every time something happens, I do what? Every time something new happens, I do what?
Could you ask us to pause and just to say hang on a minute when you're doing
I have done when you've been very absorbed in the task.
Have you answered some stuff?
Not knowing.
I was hoping that you'd acknowledge it.
Every time something interesting has happened or you've moved on to another stage, what I've done is step back a bit more.
Yes, to check whether the shelf was clean.
Yeah, and I step back a bit more,
Do you mean physically or metaphorically?
Both, actually.
Totally.
Every time I've stepped back, what I've done is what? Metaphorically, I've
looked at the bigger picture.
Yes. So I asked you to think about what you were doing, and then I asked you to think about the bigger patterns in what you were doing. I asked you to observe what each other was doing. I asked you to observe what's happening outside of the jigsaw in the way that you're interacting. I'm asking you now to comment on what you've learned about metaprograms, and I'll step back again and ask you to comment on your own overall behaviour and what the sort of default positions are. And now I'm stepping back again and asking you to now include me in that. So every series of questions that I'm asking you, I'm making the frame of reference bigger. And if we were to take all of this that we've learned in the last hour and now put that back into completing the puzzle, what would you do? Bearing in mind everything that you've now experienced and learned, where's your focus of attention now?
Mine would be on this, having a discussion about what we wanted to achieve and how we're going to do it.
Excellent.
Before we
Okay, great. So if we were to restart the exercise now, where would the rest of you, so if you all say, where would your focus be now if we were to continue with this?
Collaboration.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I'm just smiling at what my first answer was, and it's not changed. I'd just go back to doing what I was doing, which is not a good answer.
What's wrong
just,
with that?
No.
Because I thought I was doing all right.
Yeah.
I thought it was, you know.
Great.
I'd like to have said what I thought you wanted to hear, but that being honest.
What I want to hear is exactly what you say.
Yeah.
Whatever that may be.
Because I've had affirmation that I'm on the right track, we've had a discussion, and it seems like subconsciously we all slipped into our roles anyway without having to be delegated to or have the discussion. So once you've had the discussion, are you going to change anything? Are you going to change your roles? Are you going to go back and do the same role, or?
Well, I would request that Patrick, if he saw any straight lines, could you please pass them over?
Which one? Well, yeah, right, okay. But that didn't involve me, so I'm selfish. I was just passing them anyway, I was already doing that.
So you're helping other people whether they asked you to do or not, or whether they want to.
Just looked and thought.
That's something I'm going to contribute. And Patrick, if we were to restart the experiment now, where would your focus be?
I would focus on looking at what I'm compulsed to do, and then take a step back and question, why would I do that? And stretch myself by doing something different. Just be more mindful of what I'm doing.
Excellent. And stepping back again, what do your comments on what you would do if we restarted now tell you?
Learn something.
That there must be, yeah, okay.
There's a better way of doing it.
The system was working and we would have reached the end goal. However, the little thing like you thought, assumed that Patrick was passing the straight edges over and Patrick just was doing what Patrick said he would do because he didn't say he'd pass them over. So it's like refining it. Does that make sense? Yeah. Clarifying.
Again, I assumed.
Yeah. I want the picture as well.
You want the picture? And what does your comment about collaborating and having that conversation, what does that tell me?
Is it something about discussing options so that we can agree a procedure?
Interesting. For what purpose?
To complete the picture, clearly that's the task.
Is this it now, Julia? Is this what every break you get?
Life's too short.
At every stage, we could step back and make this frame reference bigger, but how do we know when to start? How do we know what the right size of that frame of reference is?
When we've got enough evidence or enough detail or enough information
to
make the big picture, to get the end goal, to...
Excellent. So there's got to be a picture, there's got to be an end goal, an outcome, there's got to be something to get to tell you what level.
Yeah.
And you might go up and down. You might adjust your level of focus in order to get to.
So in and out, like Patrick was saying.
Yeah.
Because if we're focused on the minute, then we can't.
You also, if you focus on the minute, then you're more likely to be composed. Because you lose your...
But we have to do that.
Get into it.
And then it's a bit like... the exercise with noticing what's happening to somebody on the chair. It's like once you've gone and you got into the smallest detail, the less you are able to take some distance. And
great.
So it's
the
external balancing.
Yeah. And if we only ever focus on the components at the lowest level of detail, somebody might say, "Oh, what did you do at the weekend? Oh, I finished a 3,000-piece jigsaw puzzle. What was it? Well, I don't know.
But I sorted it into different colours.
Yeah, I put every piece next to every other piece that fitted together. But I don't know what picture was. That's the staying at that low level. Yeah. Staying at the top level, just get the picture of the box and hang that on the wall.
Yeah. Mm. Job done.
Job done.
It's if like results, that part,
there's only that. Have that.
You know when we went to the cafe, the restaurant, I took a picture of a picture on the notice board of a beautiful sunset. So it's...
Oh, a picture of a picture.
Picture of a picture.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it looks like it's a picture that I took.
So. That would be a cure, wouldn't it? A picture of a picture of a picture of a smiley.
Yeah,
excellent. That's really neat, actually. You could do that. Take a picture of that. No, take a picture of my phone. That's like it. Anyway, how interesting. What an interesting experiment. And if we think back to the hillside outside, with the houses and the trees and the horses and the cars and so on, how do we look at something like that? How do we, when we're driving through the countryside, how do we look at it? How do we see it and interact with it?
Internally and externally.
Big picture first, but then we might focus on the detail.
Yeah. And out, and in, and out, and in. Yeah. And internal, external, isn't it beautiful? Internal, this is like when I went to France last year.
Yeah.
Options, where should we go next? Procedures, I think it's this way.
Mm.
Excellent work. I'm not asking you to finish it.
Nice.
If you feel so compelled,
finish it.
Yeah,
if you feel so compelled to finish it, I'll leave it here over lunchtime.
Peter,
I'm only observing on your behaviour. Many comments from the behaviour.
Let's just be grateful it's our client.
Left it in pieces.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting, given what you were saying about when Christine was in the chair? About the sense of this discomfort and has this been resolved and so on. And you just said, just be grateful it isn't a client that we've left in pieces on the table. Because of course we wouldn't do that.
I'd run 10,000 miles.
We wouldn't do that.
Yes,
but hold on.
When we approach it, it was complete mess. They were upside down and it was absolutely... So at least...
That's not complete mess.
We've left them.
So we're making
a
plan for the next
state
week.
Than we started.
Yes, right. Yes.
And if the client doesn't tell us what the edges are, how do we know when they're finished? And if they don't say, this is a picture of me as I'd like to be, make me like that.
Mm.
If they're just saying, I want to be more, or in your word, greater.
Mm.
Then how do we know? Who says when the puzzle's finished?
And if that is the client, so we've made an appointment to come back and see us or whatever, but actually, as they go away, they're not aware, really, that anything's taking place. However, it's like things are a bit more, I can't explain.
Clear.
Yeah, but they are.
It's a little bit.
It's not as messy as what it was before, but that was the first question.
An organising process
It was contained.
It was very nicely organised.
So it's
going. Thank you.
It was, and actually... Yes.
I didn't ask you to start doing my puzzle.
And actually, that's, it's in pieces now.
Well, my original question was going to ask you, Peter, we've unravelled this client, and this is the original question. So we're aware that the person's a bit... And I've had situations where I've been working with someone, and I know when they've left, I thought, I thought, well, this is part of their process, and they have come back the following week, and we've followed it through. However, I've had a couple that haven't.
Yeah.
Is there anything that we can do,
maybe
do?
Maybe they're where they want to be.
Right.
They just didn't show you the picture on the box and say, I want to be like that.
Well, there's all sorts of maybes.
I've had them disappear and I bumped into them 6 weeks later and they're looking really good and going to college and they're doing this.
Yeah.
Well, we're not doing that.
All we know is that within that limited interaction, whatever happened. We don't know what will happen next. This is exactly the conversation we had about Wesley, yes?
Mm.
Yeah, and we reflected.
And we figured, on balance, do we believe that we've left him in a good place? And will we check on that? How will we check on that?
And sometimes we don't.
Sometimes we don't have that opportunity. So is the puzzle in a better state than it started?
Depends how you define
it. Well,
It was very neat to start with. I went to some trouble to make a lovely neat pile.
The puzzle itself doesn't give a damn. In fact, the puzzle doesn't even know it's a puzzle. So the puzzle is...
It's only... Yes, exactly.
Are you up here, or...?
It's only if we say that's the outcome that we can say, is this closer or further away to that outcome than it was before? Very slightly closer, because there's only about 10 pieces that are fitted together.
Well...
maybe 15. So if our goal is, are the pieces fitted together?
Yeah, but we're identifying the patterns, behaviour.
Yeah, from three different suites.
That's on track.
By your measure.
By my measure.
Who's the client?
Yeah, absolutely.
Who defines the measure?
But that's a procedural, that's an option of procedure, isn't it? This is the way that this particular group has chosen.
And therefore,
to go
what
about
judgment is this
as
group
every different practitioner might do something differently.
And there is no right or wrong judgment. All we can ever do is be aware that we are.
Yeah.
Making a judgment on what we think is better or worse for the client. And we want to leave them in a better place as an operating principle, as an organising principle, but how do we know what that is unless...
Yeah.
Unless we do what?
Test.
Ask them and test. Rather than thinking, well, they looked happier, I did a great job. We test. And we have a point of reference. Without a point of reference, we're putting pieces together for the sake of putting pieces together. We're doing a thing because we can do it. But remember what Kurtwood Smith said in Star Trek 6?
Just
because we can do a thing doesn't necessarily follow that we must do that thing.
And listen, at least, yeah, let's move in.
Most of all, we had fun. We learned something. It was stimulating.
Absolutely.
Isn't that what we want?
And we learned.
When do we want it?
Yeah. Well, after my 10 minutes in the corner, for my naughty corner, for not passing the straight.
Fascinating. Thank you very much. There we go.
Thank you.
As I say, if you feel compelled to compete it over lunch time, you're more than welcome to.
And you were